Good morning. Welcome to worship at First Presbyterian Church of Easton. I am Pastor Stefanie. We are in the season of Lent, and that music was just a wonderful way to enter that season with the prayerful and reflectiveness that we are called into. We have a few announcements to make today, but before I do, I of course join all of you in mourning the sad news that two very faithful women have left us after over 100 years, both of them. What a week. I'm looking at Ruth Ann. Harriet Spillman passed away on the 20th. And then 3 days later, Harriet passed away. Naomi passed away. So we are waiting to have more information about their services. They will both have services here, likely in March, mid-March, late March. More information will be coming as the families coordinate those dates, and we look forward to celebrating their lives, their full, wonderful lives, celebrating how much we cared for them, and also celebrating their faith and knowing that they have been welcomed into the arms of their God. So please, Ruth Ann, our deepest prayers are with you. I know you are glad that your mom is at peace. We are in the season of Lent. We are holding our Lenten Bible study today on the book of John. We'll be meeting in the Milheim room after coffee hour. We do have coffee hour today. Please join us downstairs in Legacy Hall for some time together. Brunch Bunch, another time for fellowship, is meeting on March 12th. They will be going to the Outback Steakhouse. Please let Ruth Ann know by March 10th if you are going to join them. We have a few other announcements for meeting. The property team is going to be meeting on Zoom this Tuesday. Session is meeting March 1st in person. And then the deacons had been scheduled to meet on the 2nd, but they had such an efficient last meeting that they will not meet on the 2nd. So please look out for their next meeting, but it will not be on the 2nd. We, of course, are aware of the terrible disaster facing Syria and Turkey from the earthquakes. So we have provided for you, again, the information from the Presbyterian Disaster Assistance. It is a wonderful organization that really does have an impact on the ground. So if you are looking to help our neighbors near and far, that is a wonderful organization to support. We do note that the choirs are continuing to meet, continue to support our blessing box. Thank you for signing up to do fellowship, continue to do that. Those are the announcements that I have today. Yes.
Phyllis and Ellis prepared a really nice coffee hour downstairs. And don't tell Pastor, but we have cake and some candles. Okay? So come down.
I didn't hear a thing. Seeing no other announcements, I invite us to turn our hearts and all that we are to worshiping God. Will you join your voices with mine in this morning's call to worship? After he was baptized by John, Jesus went by himself into the wilderness. 40 days in the desert, Jesus was tempted. Today, we begin to journey with Jesus through the season of Lent, and we face some of our own weaknesses and temptations. Let us seek Christ as our companion along the way. Let us worship God and walk the journey together. Let us welcome the Spirit to prepare our hearts for Easter's coming. Amen. Please be seated. Friends, in this season, indeed, of reflection and repentance, we are invited to become before God in prayer, speaking the truth of how we have fallen short of being the people who God has called us to be. And so we pray together this morning's prayer of confession, and then we take a moment of silent prayer to speak the truth to our God. Let us together join our voices in prayer. Sheltering and guiding God, as you were present with Jesus in the wilderness experience, so you are present with us. You urge us to trust you, but we have felt abandoned and even betrayed by you when things have not gone well with us. Instead of following where you lead, O God, we follow a tempter who shows us a counterfeit vision of the world, not the whole and abundant world you desire for us. We want an easy path forward, even if it is not your will. At times, O God, we are deceived and enticed by imitations of love, abundance, and joy. O God, when you have not answered our prayers in the ways we desire, we have been tempted to lean on our own understanding. We so often have sought to order our own steps, often ignoring your wisdom and pushing your guidance aside. Lord, have mercy. Help us to trust you, to journey with us, and to guide us. Help us to rest in your promise to never leave us or forsake us. Amen. The Apostle Paul declared our hope as he asked, Who is in a position to condemn? The answer, only Christ. And Christ died for us, and Christ rose for us, and Christ reigns in power for us, and Christ prays for us. Trust the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and set free by God's generous grace. Hallelujah. Amen.
Our first reading today from the Old Testament is Psalm 32, the first seven verses. How blessed are those whose offense is forgiven, those whose sin is covered. How blessed those to whom Adonai imputes no guilt, in whose spirit is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away because of my groaning all day long. Day and night, your hand was heavy on me. The sap in me dried up as in a summer drought. When I acknowledged my sin to you, when I stopped concealing my guilt and said, I will confess my offenses to Adonai, then you forgave the guilt of my sin. This is what everyone faithful should pray at a time when you can be found. Then, when the floodwaters are raging, they will not reach him. You are a hiding place for me. You will keep me from distress. You will surround me with songs of deliverance. And our second reading from the New Testament is Matthew chapter 4. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, and afterward he was famished. The tempter came to him and said to him, If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread. But he answered, It is written, One does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down. For it is written, He will command His angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone. Jesus said to him, Again it is written, Do not put the Lord your God to the test. Again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and all their splendor. And he said to him, All these I will give to you if you will fall down and worship me. Jesus said to him, Away with you, Satan, for it is written, Worship the Lord your God and serve only him. Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him.
Let us pray. O holy God, your word is indeed a light unto the path. Guide us as we seek your word. Illuminate in us your wisdom. Speak to us the truth of your good news. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Friends, today's scripture is known as the temptation of Jesus. The Spirit of God leads Jesus into the wilderness, and there the devil tempts Jesus. Now, when you hear that, the devil, I ask that you try not to imagine all the images that might come up with the devil. This is not a creature with a red tail. There are no horns involved. This is not Hades of the underworld. In fact, the Greek word for devil, used here in this passage, diablos, can in some ways be seen as a title. It means tempter or slanderer. There in the desert, Jesus encounters the slanderer, the tempter. The devil is the personification of temptation. And yes, the word has a very distinctly negative edge to it. This otherworldly creature's purpose and core character is to mislead, to lure Jesus away from the truth of who Jesus is and who Jesus trusts. The tempter is sly and subtle. We learn that Jesus has been fasting. We fast to let go of the things that distract us from focusing on God. This is a spiritual practice that Jesus has undertaken intentionally. But Jesus is human, so Jesus is absolutely famished. And so, the subtle and sly tempter says to the very hungry Jesus, "Why don't you just turn this simple stone into some bread?" Jesus says no by quoting scripture. "One does not live by bread alone. God's word nourishes my spirit." Next, the devil, the tempter, took Jesus up to the highest tower in the holy city. And this time, did you notice that it's the devil who quotes scripture? The devil tries to provoke Jesus to prove that he could rely on God. Jesus again says no and quotes scripture back, saying we are not to put God to the test. Finally, the devil takes Jesus up to the highest mountain. What has happened up in the mountainsides before? Jesus has encountered God. He was just on the mountain with his disciples when God appeared to him and he was illuminated. But now the devil takes him up to the mountain and says, "Look out at all the world. All the splendor. I can give all of this to you if you just bow down to me." Was the devil lying? Did the devil have the power to give the whole world to Jesus? We don't know. But he could have. The treacherous entity might have just been exaggerating. But the devil tells Jesus, "All you have to do is make me your God." And again, Jesus says, "No. Away with you, I will worship and serve God alone." Jesus denied the lures of temptation. What do you think of when you think of the word temptation? In this passage, the word temptation is perizo, and it is most often translated to be to tempt, but it has a second meaning, to test. Each of these three interactions with the tempter is both a temptation and a test. To test someone and to tempt someone is very different. To tempt, what does that mean? To be allured, to be enticed, into something that is unwise or wrong. Temptation is inherently deceptive. When we are enticed, when we are tempted to do something unhealthy or unethical, we ignore the truth of our own conscience, or we delude ourselves into thinking what we want is what we need. It's inherently deceptive. We're not tempted to eating a low-calorie nourishing meal that would actually be healthy for us. We are tempted to eat an entire box of Oreos. Do I not get an amen for that? Need versus want, short-term versus long-term. We all know in the short-term, eating a box of Oreos might taste great. Insert your favorite cookie. But in the long-term, those patterns are not healthy. The temptation is deceptive. Short-term, long-term, need versus want, healthy versus unhealthy. Temptation is resistance, calls us to look at things to fill a need that we think we have. Imagine Aladdin going into the Great Hall of Thieves. Do you remember that story? And that young thief can't resist the gold. He's not supposed to touch anything else, but he can't resist. He pockets treasures, even though he knows he shouldn't. Humans, we are tempted by worldly stand-ins for status and wealth. None of those human creations fulfill our human souls. Inherently deceptive. Doesn't help us when we are tempted. Once a high schooler named, we'll call him Justin, and a friend broke a rule. At the time, lying seemed the quick and easy way for Justin to get out of his situation. He lied to his teacher, and his teacher gave him a second chance, asked him, "Are you sure you didn't do that?" He lied again. Of course, soon the truth came out. The broken rule itself was only a small infraction. The teacher probably wouldn't have even cared that much. But the lie, the quick and easy fix, it damaged Justin's relationship with his teacher. Justin was a good kid, but at that moment he was tempted. He did not need to lie, but he was embarrassed and a little ashamed. And so he forgot who he was, and he acted counter to who he was. Inherently wrong and deceptive. Temptations are lies. Be this and it'll be easier. Eat this and you'll feel good. Dress this way and everyone will see you. They are not fulfilling, these temptations. They are not sustaining, whatever might fill that category. And there was the tempter with Jesus. The devil didn't want to help Jesus when he was hungry. It was a lie, just turn this stone to bread. The devil wasn't there to support Jesus, just ask for the angels to come. The devil was not offering the way to life. The tempter was sly. He didn't encourage Jesus to conjure up a full table of decadent food. He whispered, "Just a little bread." Doesn't the tempter, or hasn't the tempter ever whispered in your ear? Just a few dollars off the top. No one will miss it. Just that staple from the office or whatever we take from offices. It's not cheating. It's just playing the game well, the tempter whispers. Everyone does it. Why not you? It's not cheating. It's not lying. It's just bending things a bit. The tempter tells us, tells you, that you have to have the biggest and the best, more and the most. This campaign only sways us if we doubt that we are not enough. The tempter says, the clothes make the man. You need those social media likes. You need those filters on your phone to look pretty and slim and young. Lies. What you need is what is healthy and whole and good. During the pandemic, when so many people were isolated, the use and abuse of alcohol rose, a poor substitute for what people really needed. Recent studies are showing us that young people are suffering as their mental health has declined. Still forming brains are scanning unrealistic images, curating superficial likes on social media, and it does the opposite of what they're seeking. They're seeking connection and relationships, and instead, they're finding their self-esteem plummeting, their sense of worth being lost. The tempter doesn't want them or us to know the truth. God loves us. We are worthy. There is hope for tomorrow. When you want to prove to everyone gathered in the room that you are the smartest, you have fallen to temptation. When you want to show off your wealth, if you believe that someone else has to be bad for you to be good, you have let the devil tell you that you are small, and you have believed the lie that you are not enough. Beware the tempter. For the truth is that God loves you, and you have nothing to prove. One of the gifts of this passage, this story, is knowing that Jesus was fully human, that Jesus knew what it was like to be tempted. Jesus knows the struggles that we go through when we're worried, when we have doubts, when we're afraid. Jesus has been there. Friends, I want to note that the Spirit of God leads Jesus into the wilderness. But that could be misunderstood. The Spirit of God does not lead us to lies and shallow wants. Out in the wilderness, Jesus was tempted and Jesus was tested. A test. What is a test? What is a test's function? As I look at some educators here. A test is to evaluate the limits of what someone or something is capable of doing or achieving. It's an evaluation. A test is a practical way of understanding the true nature of a thing. What do we test? We test students to see what they've learned because we're wanting to prepare them for the world. We test the steel in a bridge to make sure that it can hold its load. We test cars to make sure that they're safe. They're evaluations with a purpose, to come to a truth. Now, I studied in college. I was an education major, and I am so grateful for the skills and insights that my teaching courses gave me. And the one thing that I learned was that good educators use tests to evaluate the success of their lessons as well as what their students have learned, because those things go together. I've so often seen my own children be tested in ways where the test is used just to generate a grade, not to evaluate learning. It's not how testing is supposed to be. Personally, as a student, I hated being tested. I remember a time in high school when my entire class, I don't remember what class it was, we all bombed a test. The highest grade in the class was 64. All the students failed. And so what did the teacher do? Did the teacher come back to the material and have us go over it again and figure out where the disconnect was. No. The teacher changed the grades based on a curve. So all of a sudden, the 64 became an 84. The 50 was now a 70. And I remember not being elated, but actually kind of frustrated. I should have been elated, I guess, because I'm sure I was one of the lower grades. But I was frustrated because it felt so arbitrary. What was the point of being tested if the test didn't actually show what we learned? Tests have a purpose. Jesus was tested out in the wilderness. The Spirit didn't lead Jesus into the desert to just put Jesus through the ringer for the sake of entertainment. No. The Spirit led Jesus to exactly where Jesus needed to be. Jesus was about to embark on a very frightening journey. He was about to face people who questioned who he was, who would call him a criminal, who would hurt him for political gain, who cared nothing about him. He needed to know firmly who he was and that he could make that journey. It would have been cruel to send him on the road to Jerusalem, walking towards the cross, if he was not ready to do so. And so the Spirit leads Jesus, not forces or cajoles or coerce. He leads Jesus. Jesus knew that he could turn that stone to bread. He could, in fact, turn it to chocolate mousse cake. He could turn a heavy wooden beam into light sand. He could turn nails to clay. He could turn a crown of thorns into a crown of daisies, but he did not, because he knew the truth. We live more. We live not just by flesh, but by God's loving grace. Jesus knew that God's angels could come and could keep him from dashing his foot across a stone, just as he knew that days from then he could ask God to take a bitter cup away, and God would have. But Jesus freely chose to face the cross and the grave because he knew God's victory and kingdom were real. He knew the truth. Jesus knew he could conquer all the earth with his power. Jesus was the Son of God. He knew who he was. But he also knew that the power of God was not power over, but power with and for. He gave of himself, and he showed the true sacrificial and life-giving power of God. He was tempted and tested, but he knew the truth. He lived the truth. He turned away from every temptation because his commitment to and his faith in his Father was greater than all things, unwavering. So friends, as we follow Jesus this season into Lent, we will often focus on the idea of temptation. We'll give up bubble gum or potato chips. And if you were planning on doing it, that's okay. But just a nod to fasting is only meaningful if we are prayerfully reflective about why we give up certain things. If we are prayerfully reflective on the will and way of God for our life. Just giving up chocolate with no thought as to why is missing the point of the test. Giving up meat this season could be a positive spiritual discipline if it helps honor God. Perhaps if it acknowledges and tries to counter the ways that we waste and overuse resources of this planet. But if it's just mindless obligation, we miss the point of the test. Maybe instead of giving up chocolate or bubblegum or potato chips, you might give up worrying. Worrying about things that you cannot control. Each time you find yourself in a cycle of anxiety, instead, breathe and pray or recite a verse from Scripture. Seek the true power of God, God's goodness and grace. Focus on God this season. God's Spirit has led us into this time together. Times of testing by God are not traps. They're not meant to trip us up and to lead us down false paths. That's not the way of God. Lent is meant to be meaningful, a time of spiritual growth and maturity. It's not meant to be dark and depressing, where we focus on our sin and are ashamed of ourselves and diminished. That's not the point. No, the truth of this season is about truth-telling. It's about being honest about ourselves. As we revisit the record of Jesus being rejected and betrayed, which we will this season, we must not give in to the worst temptation, and that is to despair. As we recall the trials of Jesus, we might be tempted to feel defeated. Instead, let us walk with Jesus and see his faithfulness through all his trials, the strength of his faith that he has given to us. He seeks life, and so shall we. He promises us life in all its fullness. So believe in the truth of who Jesus is and what he offers you in this life and in the next. Be strengthened for all the trials and tribulations that you face. In this season and every season, let us turn to God. Amen. Brothers and sisters, siblings in Christ, God has given us so many gifts in Christ and in creation. We offer our gifts in return and in gratitude for the possibilities we enjoy, trusting God to multiply what we bring for goodness sake. Friends, this is the season also when we support the one great hour of sharing, an extra offering from our denomination. From February 22nd through April 9th, we join with Presbyterians worldwide in sharing God's love with our neighbors in need around the world by providing relief from natural disasters, food for the hungry, and support for the poor and oppressed. Please consider giving in this season. You can find the One Great Hour of Sharing fish boxes, in the rear of the sanctuary. It's also a practice to collect your pennies during this season. Let us pray. Lord God, we offer our gifts in thanksgiving for all the goodness you provide. Bless our gifts and our lives so that we may become a source of goodness for others. In the name of Christ, our strength and our hope. Amen. Let us pray. O good and loving God, we are on a journey in this life. You call us to where we need to be. You call us to be honest, truthful about both good and bad. You call us to reflect on ways that we fall short, and you call us to celebrate our own gifts and the gifts of our lives. And so we come to you in prayer. We come to you in prayer to acknowledge the hurt of this world. Lord, we pray for every member and friend of this congregation who is in the midst of dealing with ongoing health concerns, with the challenges of illness. Lord, we pray that your spirit may move, that you may bring your truth, you may illuminate and bring knowledge to what needs to be healed, that you would work through doctors and supportive staff, that we might be supportive and our loved ones might know your touch through their healing. Lord, we pray for every member and friend of this congregation who is in the midst of grief. On this day, we especially are thinking of Harriet Spillman and Naomi Smith. Lord, such full and rich lives, we celebrate, and we pray that peace and comfort might flow to the families who will miss their mother so much. We continue to pray for other families in grief. Lord, you promise peace that surpasses all understanding. Offer your peace to those who grieve. Holy One, you know all the challenges of our lives. You know the challenges that face us individually, You know the challenges that face your church community here. Help us to put our trust in you in all things, that we might live in hope, that we might trust in your grace, that we might turn to you in all things. And Lord, as we turn to you, help us to be aware of all the good that you have given us, the good and talented people who give of themselves to be part of this church family. We give you thanks for all the skills of the people that are here. We give you thanks for the generosity in time, talent, and treasures. Lord, help us to continue to bring our gifts out into our world, to share the good news with our neighbors, to be the hands and feet that you have called us to be, sharing your kindness and compassion and seeking your justice in this world. Lord, you know all our prayers in this hour. Gather them in and hold them close to you. In this we trust. And so let us together pray the prayer that Jesus taught, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
friends, as we begin our journey through Lent, remember the words of the prophet Micah. What does the Lord require of you? To do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with God. May God's loving kindness comfort you. May God's justice inspire you. And Jesus walk beside you in humility and hope. Amen.